Hey, good morning. Good morning. Welcome to Vima Church. How many guys excited to be here today? Come on. Anyone excited to be in God's house? A couple of us, yeah? I'm excited to be here. Today, we're wrapping up our red flag series, relationship series. We've just been talking about warning signs, different things in our lives that maybe should cause us to pause, reflect, maybe dig into God's word and find out, man, how do we proceed forward in our relationships? And we talked about lots of different things. We've talked about forgiveness. Last week we talked about sex. This week we're going to be talking about our words. And so lots of different conversation pieces, but I think this has been helpful. Has this helped anyone so far in this series so far? I think it's been very applicable, very helpful. And this may be the most challenging message. You're like, John, no, I was here last week. That was different. Now, I think this may be the most challenging message, but I think this one probably affects the majority of us. And so today, I just want to start just by jumping straight into God's word. So if you've got your notes, it's going to be the one scripture that we have posted there, written there. If you don't have, you got your Bible, you can pull that out. We're going to be in James chapter 3. If you don't have either of those, just a note for you. We always have Bibles available for you to use, for you to borrow, for you to take if you need one. When you walk in, same place, you get the notes, these little tables. We got God's word there ready for you to engage with. But if you don't have any of those, no worries. We're going to look at it right here. James chapter 3, verses 3 through 10. It says this: if we put bits into the mouths of horses so that they obey us, we guide their whole bodies as well. Look at the ships also. Though they are so large and are driven by strong winds, they are guided by a very small rudder, wherever the will of the pilot directs. For so also the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great things. How great a forest set ablaze by such a small fire. And the tongue is a fire, a world of unrighteousness. The tongue is set among our members, staining the whole body, setting on fire the entire course of life, and set on fire by hell. And goes on, for every kind of beast and bird and reptile and sea creature can be tamed and has been tamed by mankind, but no human being can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil full of deadly poison. How many of you feel encouraged today, right now? You're just like, man, that was a great word. Thank you. I'm ready to go tackle today. You know, this is a powerful, strongly worded. I love that James doesn't really mess around. In fact, if you read the whole book of James, he talks about very practical issues when it comes to us, our spirituality, our faith, the church, and he talks about them without any stories, without any metaphors. There's no parables like Jesus to kind of help us grasp, but he just cuts straight to the chase and says, here's what we're talking about and here's what we're dealing with. And I love how James put this. But when I was reading this, especially this last line, that our tongue, our words are full of deadly poison, I'm immediately drawn to like one of my favorite Pixar movies of all times, which is Toy Story. I love the Toy Story series. I love the tension between Woody and Buzz Lightyear. Like, there's so many fun things and fun characters, but Woody's my favorite character. He's noble. You know, he's always trying to care for others. He's kind of the hero in most of the Toy Story movies. And if you ever watched him, you know he's the cowboy. He's the old toy in the toy box. And he's a rag doll with a couple plastic pieces. And one of the things that makes Woody unique is that, and separate from Buzz, is that Buzz comes out with all these buttons that you can push, and you push the buttons and he does things. His wings pop out, he says phrases, stuff like that. But Woody is old school. Woody's got the pull string. And when you pull the string on Woody, he's got a couple catchphrases, as any famous toy or famous hero or famous doll would have. And I love his catchphrases, and they're kind of iconic to his character. You know, one of them, when you pull the string, is reach for the sky. You know, the cowboy, he's got his pointing his gun at the bad guy, right? Or you're my favorite deputy. You know, that's the little kid, like, you know, oh, that's so sweet. And then he says, there's a snake in my boots. and then probably my favorite one is just an odd one, and it has to kind of do what we're talking about today, is somebody poisoned the water hole. You know, it's kind of an odd thing, like, reach for the sky, cowboy, get it, yep. And then you get, you're my favorite deputy. Okay, cowboy, little kid, get that. There's a snake in my boots. That's kind of fun. You know, like, he's in the West, he's out in the desert, there's snakes, get that. And then somebody poisoned the water hole. Like, that's kind of dark, Woody. And all of a sudden, too, like, that's a phrase that now is not just about him or himself. That's almost a phrase that affects everybody. It's like a warning. And I think this is what James is getting at here, too, is that, like, this is a warning. And this is really what we've been talking about in this whole series, is these warning signs, these flags. And I think that James drawing this metaphor here, and if we can tie in the Woody metaphor, poison in the water hole, is like, we got to be careful, because things that look normal, things that maybe look okay to partake in, and things that maybe look okay to drink or be around, may actually be harmful. And things that we may think are no big deal at all may actually have quite a bit of harm attached to them. And I think this is what James is getting to with this idea about our words being poison. One drop of poison doesn't seem like a lot in a large vase of water, yet if you've watched any movies, you've seen a walk by the spy and then just a little drip and they keep going, right? Like, we know that's harmful. We know that that's a big deal. And this is the metaphor that James gives us here, is that our words are like poison. It may just be something small that's said, but it's never just small. And you may think it just has an effect to that one person, but oftentimes it doesn't just affect just one person. And somebody poisoned the water hole, that's not just about the one person that's going to drink. It's about the many people that are going to come and grab a drink there. And James gives us many metaphors in this. He talks about the bridle on a horse and how that steers. He talks about the rudder of a ship and a spark that sets a fire ablaze. But in this, it's not just any fire, though. As we looked at this, when James says this, I'm going to back up here. He goes, it's not just a fire, not just any fire. It's not just a tongue of fire, not just unrighteous fire. But he says this, that it has the ability to stain the whole body. It affects everyone, our words do, an entire course of life. And then look what James says. It's set on fire by hell. James is drawing a very clear picture here that our words have the ability to be used by Satan. And that these things are not just flippant things. In fact, that there's things that the enemy would want to use. And it's interesting, the metaphors, he's talking about the fire that sets ablaze and takes life. Well, we know what Satan's goal is here. It's to steal, kill, and destroy. And so James is saying the tongue is something that Satan would leverage to accomplish his mission here on earth. I mean, this is a strong heeding. It's a strong warning to the things that we say. That he's saying that our words have the potential to be used by Satan himself to steal, kill, and destroy. And as proof of this, Jesus is having a conversation with Matthew. And Matthew says, Matthew chapter 16. And he's telling Peter about how he's going to die, he's going to rise again. And there's this tension point. And Peter argues with Jesus. And it says, Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. He started correcting Jesus. It's not a good idea, okay? And so he pulls him aside, at least he didn't do it in public, and starts rebuking him, saying, far be it from you, Lord, this shall never happen to you. They're never going to capture you. They're never going to kill you. That's not going to happen. But Jesus turned to him and said, Peter, get behind me, Satan. What does Jesus recognize? He's recognizing that the words that are coming out of his mouth are not full of life. The words that are coming out of his mouth are not even necessarily his words. That the enemy is using his words to come against Jesus himself. Now, this seems like a very, like, stark and staunch conversation, but it's clear that our words have power, and our words come from places. They do. And so let's look at Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21. This is scripture probably many of you have heard. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. And so our words, we see this very clearly right here, and you guys know this. If you've been in church, you've heard this phrase before, but our words carry the potential of life or death. And so when talking about relationships, talking about red flags, I mean, this affects every context of every relationship that you have. If you're married in the room, you know this to be true. If you've got kids in the room, you know this to be true. If you've got friends in the room, you know this to be true. If you work with people in the room, you know this to be true. If you have any kind of contact with people that last anything longer than a minute or two, you realize that things that people say can cause harm. And many of us in the room have been affected by that. Many of us in the room are actually walking in today carrying the wounds of words. Maybe someone actually didn't do anything to you, but they said something to you, And the irony is, if someone does something to us, we can actually see the healing take place. But when they say something to us, oftentimes we bear those wounds for a long, long, long time. And so there's a poem that's written about our words, and I just want to read this to you because I think this is so powerful. It says, "Who am I? I have no respect for justice. I maim without killing. I break hearts and I ruin lives. I am cruel and malicious, and I gather strength with age. The more I am quoted, the more I am believed. I flourish at every level of society. My victims are helpless. They cannot protect themselves against me because I have no name and I have no face. To track me down is impossible. The harder you try, the more elusive I become. I'm nobody's friend. Once I tarnish a reputation, it is never the same. I topple governments and I ruin marriages. I destroy careers and I cause heartache and sleepless nights. I wreck churches and I separate Christians. I spawn suspicion and I generate grief. I make innocent people cry on their pillows, and even my name hisses. I am gossip." And that's today's topic, gossip. And it's our final red flag. And this is something I think that if we were all honest, the reality is we all have partaken in this. Probably more recently than we would feel comfortable admitting in the room. Probably more recently than any of us would feel comfortable even admitting to people that we love. And so why would we talk about this? One, I think it affects us. But two, the word gossip and conversations of gossip are mentioned and talked about in the Bible 133 times. So this is not a light issue. It's mentioned in the New Testament. It's mentioned when it comes to the early church and Acts and in Romans and Ephesians. It's mentioned in Proverbs as words of wisdom. It's mentioned all throughout the Bible. And so the Greek word for gossip is this word, and I'm gonna look at how I have it pronounced right here. It's citherist, is how you say this. And this word is found in Romans 1:29. That's one of the primary instances of it, but it basically means a whisper. And so the Greek translation of the word gossip means a whisper. In fact, there's a Greek scholar named Godet who describes a gossiper as someone who pours out his poison by whispering in your ears. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 28, "A dishonest man spreads strife, and a whisperer separates close friends." Think about how many things that are said in quiet. Anything that we often say with a hushed tone or with a whisper is not very often for the benefit of someone else. Anytime we tuck away at work, or anytime we send a text message that we don't want anyone overlooking our shoulder, anything that we often say in this kind of tone is typically not for someone's betterment. It's typically not for someone's encouragement. And here's why we have to talk about this today, is that I believe that in our society that gossip is socially accepted, but it's also relationally destructive. Like, it's accepted. It's just part of the way of life. It's just part of how we do life. It's part of many of our relationships. It's part of some of our marriages. But we got to recognize that it is relationally destructive. Dave Ramsey, who's not a great theologian, but he does have this thing called entree leadership, where he talks about leadership a lot. And this was his definition of gossip. I thought was great. And this applies a little more to the workplace, but I thought it was still good for us today. Gossip is a negative discussed with anyone who cannot solve the problem. Gossip is a negative who's discussed with anyone that cannot solve the problem. And where this quote is taken from, he's got an all-staff meeting, and he's got a couple hundred people that work for him. And you can look it up on YouTube, and Dave Ramsey basically goes on like a six-minute rant, and it was like, "If I catch you gossiping, I'm firing you today." Like, he was just clearing it out. He's like, "I'm not dealing with this anymore." And so he was directly addressing the workplace. Proverbs 6, let's look at another scripture today. 16 through 19 says, "There are six things that the Lord hates, seven that are an abomination to him. Haughty eyes, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans, feet that make haste to run to evil, false witness who breathes out lies, and one who sows any discord among his brothers." Out of these abominations, out of these things that the Lord hates, you could say four of these are easily about the words that we say. I mean, we think about the things that God would hate, the type of sins. In fact, I don't know if you do this, but sometimes when I see people who've done horrendous things, I'm just like, man, how far have they had to go to do something like that. That's horrible. Yet in the list of things that the Lord hates are things that maybe we participate in on a regular basis. I mean, it's pretty crazy, and I think this is why we've got to talk about this. In fact, this is not just something that the church talks about. This is something that psychologists and sociologists, people are talking about culture and history, have been talking about for a long time. In fact, I want to show you something because I think this will be really helpful. There's a guy named Stephen Cartman. He's a psychologist in the 1960s who came up with a cycle that today I think is still being used and it's accurate, and it's all about this topic of gossip, and I want to show you this. And so basically he says that there's a couple people involved, and you know how this works. Let's say there is this person right here, and I'm just going to put a P, and that is the persecutor. That's the person that does something, harm, that says something, whatever it is, they caused the conflict that now comes to this person, which is the victim. And so there is a conflict. They did something, they said something, and so now this person is hurt by that person. This person is frustrated. It's not always pain. Sometimes it's frustration. Like sometimes it's annoyance. Sometimes it's just a confusion. Like I don't know why this person would do this, but for whatever reason, there's this the perpetrator, and then there's the victim. And here's where the problem comes in. This is where a lot of us deal and struggle with this. Is that it's hard to go back to this person. It's hard to go back to this person and have a conversation. And so what do? We invite a third person into the conversation right here. And so what we do is we take this, I'm gonna move this side of the board here so I can write from this side. We take this this conversation to this next person, and this person, we'll call them the rescuer. So it's R for rescuer. And so what we're doing is we bring our problem to this person. We say, hey, man, can you believe that so-and-so, yada, yada, yada. And what does this person do? I know. They did it to me too. I've seen them do it before. I can't believe they did that. So the reason that we bring this to this person, is because this person affirms us. They rescue us. They tell us what we want to hear. They affirm our position and our feelings. And so then all of a sudden, this person now is armed with some gossip. And oftentimes, this person, especially if they're a malicious person, they have no problem going and bringing that back to the perpetrator. And even if it doesn't get directly to them, it makes it to a person or two along that line that gets back to there. And so what this is called, what Dr. Stephen Cartman called this, and I love this phrase, he called this the drama triangle. He said, this is how drama happens in the workplace. This is how drama happens in our families, is that someone does something, says something that causes something, and this person feels a victim to it. And so they go and they tell the person that affirms that, then that person along the way, and sometimes this is not just one person, this could be multiple people along the way, and all of a sudden we end up with this drama triangle. And this is the path that every person has taken from some point in time. If you're in a room, you've taken this path. And we go to the people who tell us that we're right, because I think sometimes we're afraid if we go to the other person, we might find out that we're not as right as we thought we were. Like the truth may actually bring clarity, and the clarity may reveal that we may also be a participator in the wrong. So we go to the person that affirms us. And I would say it this way, it's easier to step into the comfort of validation than it is the discomfort of confrontation. It's easier to step into the comfort of validation than the discomfort of confrontation. And so if you're wondering if you've ever taken part in a drama triangle, I'm going to give you a couple examples for us here today. Tell the truth. Think about this if any of these identify with you. Maybe you're in a room and your mom has done something to aggravate you, to annoy you. And instead of calling your mom, you call your sister, your brother, to talk about mom. And like, what are we going to do about mom? And what are we going to do about this situation? What are we going to do about that thing that she's planned or this thing that she wants to do or that conversation or that way that she said that thing? Maybe when you're a coworker, take a work example, a coworker comes in late. You don't go to them, you go to your friend on the other side of the cubicle and like, why are they always late? They always have an excuse. Like, are they lazy? Are they incompetent? Do they not care about the job? I've heard yada, yada, yada. And so when we see our coworker, an interesting thing about that example is, have you, anyone in the room ever been late to anything that they were supposed to be at? Anyone in the room? A couple of us are telling the truth today. We always have a good excuse, right? We know why we're late, but what we don't know is why they're late, and that's why we go and talk about it. Think about this. When your spouse doesn't seem to do their share around the house, it may be easier to call your bestie than it is to call or talk to your spouse. When your friend leaves you on read for a few days, you text them and say, let's hang out, let's go do something, let's grab coffee, and they don't even reply for 3 or 4 days, it's easier to go talk to the other friend that also knows them and like, I wonder what's up with them. Oh, since they started dating so-and-so, I'm not important anymore. You know, and here's the reality is that we've all been caught in one of these drama triangles. And so gossip, this is what I want you to see, is that gossip is a predictable behavior that happens in every relationship in every context. It is. And this is why we're talking about, this is why it's the last one, because I think it'll apply to the most of us in the room. It's a behavior that happens in every relationship, in every context, happens in your family, happens in your marriage, happens in your work, happens in your friendships, happens in your school. It even happens, God forbid, in the church, right? And some of us, in fact, you're here today because this happened to you at a different church. And the pain that that caused drove you from that place to find a new place. Yeah, glad you're here. And so some of us, like, we move and we make different decisions and we make different connections. Some of us have quit jobs because of these kind of things. Some of us have lost friend groups because of these kind of things. These things cause pain. And this is what I want you to know, and we saw this in James, is that gossip is in our sin nature. It's something that every one of us is going to deal with at some capacity. It's tempting, it's luring, it's pulling us in. And it's often our natural response. Let's go back to this idea about a whisper, Proverbs 16:8. The words of a whisper, got my illustration here, some M&Ms, are like delicious morsels. That's what it says. They go down into the inner parts of our body. And this is like the thing about like M&Ms. I don't know if you've done this before, but you can't eat one M&M. Have you ever, like, my friend John, he has a jar of candy at his house. And it's so wrong because you can't just eat one. There's always Hershey Kisses in it. You can't just eat one Hershey Kiss. You open one up, and then all of a sudden you find yourself with a shrapnel of foil around you, covered in foil, and you're wondering what happened, right? And that's the thing about these delicious morsels. You start eating them, and you're like, I can't just eat one. You know what else is like this? Doritos. I don't even like Doritos, but if I eat one Dorito, I'll eat a whole bag of Doritos. I just stay away from them. This is how he described this. As the worst whispers. These words of whispers, gossip, is like delicious morsels. Things like this. Maybe you've been around someone that said something like this, or maybe you said something like this before yourself. Oh my, did you hear about so-and-so? The delicious morsel. That's a fun conversation, right? Can you believe what she did? Pop another. I'm not going to keep eating these because I won't be able to talk. Do you believe what she did? It's so frustrating that they don't ever. I wonder if he even knows that when he says that, this is response. I bet I know how they afforded that new car. Man, it must be nice to go on a vacation like that. They must have parents that. Oh, I'm sure the reason that she did that was because this. Like, we just, these phrases that we start off with, and then you can fill in the blank with whatever you want to fill in the blank with, but we start off and they're delicious morsels. Like, this is how the writer of Proverbs puts this. It's easy to do. It's tempting to do. It's fun to do. And in fact, I've heard this quote before, that gossip can travel around the world and back before truth gets to put its pants on in the morning. Like, that's how fast gossip, it's just these little morsels, these little tasty treats that we get to drop into conversations and we get to start and speak. And when we spread gossip, this is what I think we got to understand, is that we're spreading gossip, we're talking about people that God loves and that God has chosen, that God cares for, and that God has a plan for, yet we're taking these little tasty morals and morsels and starting to slowly tear apart their lives. So I'll give you four truths about gossip. Gossip hurts the person you talk about. Gossip hurts the person you talk about. You're like, okay, John, I get that. It's obvious. Gossip also hurts the person you talk to. You know that? You think, I'm just bringing this little tasty morsel to someone, just a little conversation. It's just 5 minutes. But you actually tempted them to bring them into a conversation that was ungodly. You actually hurt them. You brought sin into their life. That little spark, you brought it into their life and you caught something ablaze. So gossip is not just about the person you talk about. It's not just the person you talk to. Gossip also hurts the person who talks, who does the talking. The person who's doing the talking, Satan is gaining a threshold in your life, a foothold in your life. And this is what we see even with Peter and Jesus, that conversation, that even the enemy can take control of our words. If we're not careful, our words can be used by him for his schemes. And so gossip actually hurts us. And here's the truth. Gossip, it hurts everyone. It's not this soft, no big deal conversation. But here's the reality. I want to be very truthful with most of you in the room today. You probably feel this way. Most of the time, the intention of gossip is not to actually hurt someone. It's just to make ourselves feel better. Most of the time, when we say something about someone else, we're not actually trying to be mean towards them. We're not actually, that's the reason we whisper. We don't want to like get in some big dramatic conversation. We don't want to have that confrontation. We just want to say enough about someone else that makes us feel better about ourselves. But here's the truth I want you guys to see. Feeling better through the pain of someone else is a wicked way to correct your insecurity. Like to make yourself feel better by saying something negative about someone else is a wicked way to gain confidence in your life. To say something or to repeat something or to talk about something you maybe don't have all the information about when it comes to someone else, to do that to feel better about yourself, it's a wicked way to feel validated. It's a wicked way to feel affirmed. Ephesians 4:29 says this, "Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouth, but only such as is good for the building up as it fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear." So I think we know this, and you guys have probably heard this before, but tearing someone down to build yourself up is not godly. In fact, I would say tearing someone down to build yourself up is the exact same approach that Satan took to Jesus when he was in temptation in the desert. He was saying, if I could get Jesus to step down from his calling, if I could get Jesus to step out of what he knows is right and wrong, if I can tempt Jesus to participate in this, to eat of the bread, or to jump off of that building and call the angels to rescue him, or to go ahead and step into his kingly throne on earth right now. If I can get Jesus to come out of the position and the calling and the holiness and the righteousness of his life and take these things on now, then I get to build myself up. That's exactly what Satan's tactic. I want to take you down so I can build me up. In order to encourage our own souls, we'll go back to this, gossip poisons others. And so what is gossip? My definition is this. Gossip is the celebration of someone else's sin and shame. Gossip is the celebration. It's and you're like, I've never thrown a party around gossip. Yeah, but it makes you feel a little better. It may not be like lighting fireworks and singing a song, but the reality is it lifts us up a little bit while we bring someone down. And this is true whether you're speaking it or you're listening to it, because listening to gossip is not a harmless crime. Giving ear to something unkind makes you an equal participant. In church, I think this is the area that we've got to learn to be better at. We may be always thinking about, I need to not say that, or I need to watch who I might say those things to. I need to be careful what I say about. I think that's a natural disposition as Christians. We're trying to watch the words that come out of our mouths, hopefully so. But I think maybe where we get tripped up is we don't watch the words that we allow to come in our ears. And so it's not just what are you saying, it's also what are you listening to? Because when you listen to gossip, you're affirming and participating as if you might have as well been saying it. And in fact, someone once told me that silence is basically a quiet affirmation. You know, and so by not saying anything at all, we're basically affirming that position. So even if someone brings us something, it's like, hey, did you know about this? Hey, wonder why this is happening. Hey, this is really frustrating. Hey, I don't like the way that they're doing this. And even our silence forms some form of affirmation and confirmation in this. And so I would say this, and I think this is the big truth I want you to go home with, is that this, gossip is the opposite of the gospel. It runs in opposition to the gospel. Gossip runs in opposition to the gospel. The gospel is known as this. It's known as what? Good news to all who hear it, and it brings them life. Gossip is bad news to all who hear it, and it brings death. Gossip is the opposite. It's the opposition. It runs in friction against the gospel. And so as people who are trying to walk in a gospel-minded life, people who are trying to walk on mission, and they're maybe hoping that their lives would make a difference, and they're hoping that their actions would make a difference, and they're hoping that as people see us that they would see Christ, we have to recognize that gossip runs in contradictory to the gospel that we're representing. And so when we entertain gossip, we're becoming a poor witness. We're spreading bad news when what we're supposed to be doing is spreading good news. Matthew chapter 12 says this, I tell you, on the day of judgment, people will give an account for every careless word they speak. This is maybe one of the scariest scriptures in the whole Bible, because this doesn't say that they will give account for every malicious word that they speak. I get that. Someone who's evil, someone who says hurtful things with intentionality, with cursing, with like those kind of things, people who take the Lord's name in vain, I get that, it's malicious. People who would corner you and ridicule you, people who are bullies, people who use your pain to lift themselves up, I get that. Malicious words, those deserve a penalty. That's not what the scripture says. Scripture says we'll have to give an account for every careless word. I think how many times we've had conversations where we didn't count our words. How many times we've said something about someone or about a situation or about a friend group or about our spouse or about a parent or about our work or about an assignment, about a project, about a teacher, about a friend, about our church, about our small group, about, you know, think how many times we say things we don't count the words. This is what the scriptures are heeding to the careless words. So I want to give you some, I built the case. You guys get it. Gossip's not good. So what do we do? What are some things that we can do to like how we keep ourselves from falling into these kind of conversations? How do we protect ourselves? Like if it's around every corner and if it's around every hurt, every confusion, every frustration has the potential to spur a gossip. Like that's the natural response. Our natural response is to go to someone else, but our spiritual response should be to go to that person. And so how do we get better at that? Like how do we turn that corner? So here's some questions that I want to give you that I think we should ask before we speak. Okay, questions to ask before we speak. Here's the first one. Is this my story to tell? It's a great question to ask if you have a piece of information. Is this mine to tell? Did I just happen to stumble upon this piece of information, or is this my? Is this my story? Is this my life, or is this someone else's? If it's someone else's, let them tell the story. If it's someone else's life, let them tell the story. If it's someone else's pain, let them tell the story. If it's someone else's mistake, let them tell the story. That's the first question. Is this my story to tell? Here's another one. Is this true? This is a great question. Is even what we're talking about true, or is it speculated? If it's true, that makes it easy. Like, hey, if there's some truth to this, there may be a follow-up. There may be a conversation that needs to happen in a certain way. But I think a lot of the times, a lot of the conversations we're having are based off of speculations and assumptions. We are the greatest detectives when it comes to gossip. Like we put together so many details, like we're like CSI, right? Someone comes and drops one little morsel and all of a sudden we have a 30-minute conversation off of a 10-second interaction. Think about how we do that. Like we start breaking it down and like, well, when they said it, their body was slightly shifted to the right. And I was watching CSI, and when someone's fidgeting with their pocket, it's a lie. And so I saw him, he kind of stuck his hands in and messed with his keys. So based off his body position and the keys and all that, I know he was lying. And so now, if it's a lie, man, why do you think he was lying? What was that even about? You know, I heard he had a date with so-and-so a week ago. I wonder how that went. I heard. You see how these things like work? Like we start playing detective and assuming. So if we start with truth, then that helps us. Well, I don't know if that's, I'm not CSI detective. I can't tell if you're leaned a certain way, if you're telling the truth or not. That's not me. All right. So here's the next question. Is this helpful? Does it bring life? So is the conversation I'm about to have, is it helping anyone? Is it bringing life to anyone? And here's a showstopper right here. If you get to this point, here's another question you can ask. Can this be said out loud? If it can't be said out loud, chances are you might be starting up a drama triangle, or like what James would say, you might be starting up a spark that lights a forest on fire. And so can it be said out loud, or is it a whispering thing? Is it a conversation? In fact, one of my pastors growing up, when I first started working in the church, he called a staff meeting, and we all came in, and he said, everyone sit down. He said, it's going to be about a five-minute conversation. It's like, okay, that's never good. Anytime someone says, I only need 5 minutes and sit down and shut the door, it's not going to be good. And so this is what he said. He says, if I walk through the hallway and I catch someone whispering again, you won't have a job here. He's like, if it can't be said out loud or you can't schedule a meeting, don't do it. Like, I don't, because even if what you're saying isn't causing harm, it's leading to speculation and assumption by other people that you're trying to keep pieces of information from them. Or maybe that there's some inner circle that has information that they can't have. And that's not what I'm not having private meetings that I'm keeping information from you. So that's not from me. And so he just came out and said, if it can't be said out loud, don't say it. If it needs to have a meeting with the door closed, schedule a meeting. So really helpful there. Here's another question. Would I want this said about me? If what I'm about to say, that's a question we can ask. If what I'm about to say is helpful or harmful, would I want this to be said about me? And this is a big question for us when we're talking about other people, talking about conversations. This is something some of you need to ask, is who am I talking to? Can I trust these people? You know, sometimes there are conversations where we need, and we're talking about gossip here, but sometimes there's conversations that I've had private with people and I'm seeking counsel before I go have a confrontation. Like, and that, there's some godly wisdom to that, to go to someone and say, hey, I've got this situation and here's what happened. I'm going to tell you this story and I would love for some insight. Seeking counsel from a godly person that can speak into your life, that maybe has some experience and has some authority, that's different than gossip. And so then the question then I'm going, is this a person I can talk to and I can trust? Because if you've had a few of these conversations, you realize sometimes this person that's the rescuer actually causes you more pain. Because this person, if you're not careful, can victimize your confessions. Or not victimize, excuse me, weaponize your confessions. You come and say, well, this is what I saw, or this is what happened, and then you walk away, and then all of a sudden, whoa, there's a fire. Well, you just lit a little spark, but man, they weaponized what you said. Has that ever happened to anyone in the room? Where you said something you didn't think was that big a deal, but all of a sudden now it's a lot bigger deal because the person you handed it to couldn't be trusted with it. So that's a question. Who am I talking to? And here's the last one. Have I spoken to the other party first? Have I spoken to the other party first? So as Christians, I think this is the question. If you're a hearer of gossip, this is a question. This is the easiest way for you to get out of gossip. If someone comes up and starts saying, hey, this is what's going on, or hey, I'm not sure about this, or hey, this is offensive to me, or whatever it may be, I think one of the easiest ways you can get out of that is the first thing you say is, hey, before you go any further, I've got a question for you. Have you talked to that person yet? And I tell you, I've used this quite a few times. And not only did it end that conversation, it also ended a lot of other conversations about those type of things. Typically, this is a one and done question. Because here's what happens, and my youth pastor used to always say this, is that trash comes to the trash collector. And so if you find gossip continuing to come to you, maybe it's because you're listening to it. Maybe it's because you're affirming it. But if all of a sudden you put up a sign that says, no trash here, they're going to go find somewhere else to dump it. They're going to find someone else who will embrace it, someone else who will love it, someone else who will affirm it. Hey, your trash is pretty. I like your trash. Come look at my pile of trash. You know, this is what gossip is. It's like this comparison of trash. But when you say, hey, I am a child of God, I'm a son and daughter of God, they are a child of God, they are a son or daughter of God, then what we're saying is there's no trash here because I'm not going to heap my trash on other people. I am not a person that's going to accept trash. I'm not worthy of trash. God loves me. He created me. God doesn't want these things in my spirit. He doesn't want these things in my life. So I reject your trash, dump it somewhere else. And I'm also not going to be someone who's dumping trash on other people because I believe the same God that created me and loves me and cherished me loves them too. And so this is a no trash zone. No trash at Vima Church, all right, except the dumpster out there. That's where it goes. And this question right here has the ability, I think, to shut down many conversations. And once it happens a couple of times, then all of a sudden you become known, maybe as someone, in fact, someone has said this about me I tried to talk to John about this, he just didn't care. Well, they misinterpreted, I do care, I just don't want to talk about it like that. And so I'm okay with that. Like, you may be known as someone who people can't go and dump trash on. And I think that's an okay thing. Because the people who really do want your help, they'll come to you a different way. They're not going to come and say, look at all this trash. They're going to come to you and say, I need help. I need advice. I need insight. And so I want to leave you with this scripture today. Proverbs 16:24 says this. Kind words are like honey. Sweet to the soul and healthy for the body. Two different perspectives today on our words. Poison or honey. Hurtful or helpful. Sour or sweet. What will your words be marked with? And this is what I pray. I pray that I'm the kind of person that my words are marked with honey. I pray that we're the kind of church that our words are marked with honey. I pray that our small groups are the kind of places that where they're marked with honey. They're marked with people who are encouraging other people, praying for other people, cheering other people on.